my son is on this travel baseball team, and his coach tells them when they're down a couple runs and they need to pep it up and they need to get going, and he turns to the little kids and he goes, you know, why not us, kids? Why not us, guys? Why can't we do this? And that was something that kind of reminded me of something when I was on these journeys to try and better myself. I would say, why not? Why not us? Why not me? Why not? Why can't I be like that guy? Why can't I be like Tom? Why can't I be healthy? Why can't I be the guy that eats right, that exercises, that has a normal life, that isn't doing what I'm doing?
I'm on my way. I'm on my way. I'm on my way. Hard work done paid off. Said I'm on my way.
How's everybody doing?
Good.
How are you? I'm Dan Ratkewitch. I've been in the HMR program for a year and a half. I started on July 15th, 2015, and I lost 110 pounds on the program. I'll show you. This is the guy that I was. This was taken on in December of 2014. This is the guy that my six-year-old son Vincent lovingly refers to as Fat Daddy. I show him pictures and he looks at it and I'm like, who's that? It's Aunt Lissy and Fat Daddy in the picture. And actually in the iPhone, if you look on, they have like, they can recognize faces. And there's a whole thing on, like, I can look at all the pictures of my wife, of my kids, of me, and there's two categories, one for me now and one for me then, that the iPhone can't figure out who is who, which is pretty cool. I did decision free in phase one, and I'm really excited to be back in phase one. I know that you look at me that I'm crazy to be back in phase one, but when I look back at it, this was the best time of my life. It was the most difficult time of my life, but it turned out to be the best thing that I've ever done. I did three shakes and two entrees because I thought that I would be most successful with that, the way that I was eating, the way that I was used to eating. I wanted something extreme, but I wanted to set myself up for success. And I thought that at least I had something to eat, even though it was those little tiny boxes. I would be more successful doing that than all the shakes. But what worked for me won't necessarily work for you. Everyone is different. What works for you might not work for me. But Kira had asked me to come in and speak to the groups, because maybe there's a nugget or something that you can get out of my story and help you and help me, because this has been more powerful for me this week than anything else. This is also, as Tom mentioned, to honor the memory of Jim Lassus, who was a patient here in the HMR program that passed away. And I never got the opportunity to meet Jim, but about 30 days into my phase one, I came down to this room. The room was set up the other way around. We were facing that way back then.
What happens sometimes is
they try and confuse it, yeah. Keep you on your toes. One day it was in a circle. That was my favorite. But Kira was sitting here with Dr. Lau, and Dr. Lau usually isn't in here. And we walked in. It was kind of weird. That it was kind of like I had this feeling when I was in elementary school, and I got off the bus, and Mom and Dad were both sitting in the living room waiting for me, going, "We have to talk." So Kira had told us that Jim had passed away. And I went home that night, and my wife asked me how was the meeting. I said it was kind of weird. You know, we didn't have our normal meeting. Kira was talking about how a patient was part of the program and he passed away. And I start thinking, because this is now 30 days into this that I've been doing this, and I'm thinking, that's terrible. If I spend the next 9 months of my life miserable like this, eating these little tiny meals, not enjoying myself, not going out, not doing what, and then to pass away, I don't want to spend the next 9 months of my life doing that. And I spoke to Kira, and Kira talked me off the ledge, and I spoke to my wife, and she talked me off the ledge, and obviously I continued the program and went through it. And I'm so thankful I did, because it turned out to be the greatest thing I've ever accomplished in my life. And
I spoke to Liz last night, who is Jim's wife. She was here last night. And I was a little hesitant telling that story. And she told me that that was the best thing for Jim. And Jim thought that was the best thing that he accomplished in his life as well. So what I was saying was the same thing that she was telling me that Jim was feeling. So even though he had a short time after that, it was well worth it and he was happy. And I'll tell you that my process going through it, as I started to lose weight, the compliments and the acknowledgments and the feeling of accomplishment that I had was worth it. I mean, I could have passed away and I would have been okay because of what I went through and what I felt that I accomplished by doing that. And I know that's kind of morbid and terrible thing to say, but one of the things I bring up the 30 days because 30 days was a tough time for me to die because I'm sure like some of the people in this room, this wasn't the first diet that you're on. This wasn't the first diet that I was on. This is going to be the last diet that I'm on though. I've tried and failed over and over and over again with different diets, different things, different ideas, different concepts. And I would get to the 30-day mark and I would fall off the wagon because 30 days is long enough for you to feel like you're suffering and it's tough and you're giving up all these things and you feel like it's tough and weighing on you. But 30 days when you're 110 pounds overweight is not long enough for anybody to notice. So I feel good, I'm working out, I'm doing all these things, I'm suffering. I go up to the bank and I look at the bank teller and I'm smiling and, you know, here you go, hi Dan, how are you? And that's it. Nobody noticed anything. So I would get discouraged and I would fall off the wagon. And that's why this program was so important for me, because these groups coming here every week, getting weighed, putting my numbers up on the board, being able to bounce ideas. Well, if I heard somebody say camaraderie in the group, you know, it's a family. You know, we would come to the group and I'd share things with my group that I wouldn't share with my wife sometimes. She wouldn't want to hear them. But people here understood what I was going through. About this time, and I say 9 months because I looked on, or a year, I looked on the HMR website when I first started, and I looked at a couple of the testimonials, and I saw a couple of people that lost 100 pounds, and they did it in 9 months. And on the little fine print, it says, results not typical. But I figured, you know what, if I really stick to it and I really do well, you know, maybe I can do this in 9 months. So I gave myself 9 months that I was going to invest my life into doing this. It was about the same time that my wife watches The Real Housewives of New Jersey, and that Teresa and her husband were going to jail for something or other. And I think of these wacky things in my brain, and I'm thinking, you know, well, you know, if I ever went to jail, which I don't do anything that would cause me to go to jail, but if I were to go to jail, I would work out every day, and I'd, you know, have these tiny little meals, and I'd be in good shape, and I'd come out, and I'd be all buff, and I'd be ready. And it was also around the same time that my little sister got married and she got pregnant and had a baby. And it was 9 months that she couldn't eat sushi, she couldn't eat, you know, certain things, she had a strict diet, she couldn't drink alcohol. And she started as my little sister, and at the end of the 9 months, she was a mother. She had these superpower mother powers that she could smell things from 10 miles away and she could, you know, have these instincts to care for her child. So I looked at these two things and I'm like, I'm gonna look at this as being reverse pregnant. And I'm gonna sit there and I'm gonna eat right, eat these tiny things and stick to it. And for 9 months, I'm gonna come out a different person on the other end of it. People ask me, you know, what caused me to do this? What, you know, what made me do this? And I really, there's a million different things that caused me to walk through those doors. I've been trying to better myself for as long as I can remember. I've been working on it. I've been dieting. One of the things is I'm an Allstate agent. My agency is in East Meadow. We sell car insurance, house insurance, and life insurance. And I have two young kids, and I needed to buy a life insurance policy. And I don't know if anybody knows how life insurance works, but you're rated based on your age and your health, and there's a standard rating. And, you know, that's for average people, and you get an average rate. And then if you're, you know, in pretty good shape, you get a preferred rating, which is a little less expensive. And then if you're like Tom in the back, you know, all buff and, you know, all healthy and everything, you get a preferred elite rating. On the other end of that spectrum is table ratings. There's A, B, C, D, and, you know, they don't want to say unpreferred or non-preferred or anything like that. But I went through the tests and did the physicals and did everything, and I got a table D rating. Does anybody know what happens, what the rating is after a table D rating? Decline. And the table D rating is 4 times more expensive than the standard rating, because the insurance company, the bean counters, the people that are figuring all this math out, figure that I am 4 times more likely to die a premature death than a standard rated person. And that scared the hell out of me, because this is what I do, this is my job, I've been doing this for a long time, I know what that means. And that was something that really pushed me to do that, because now we're talking about statistics and math, and this is not just, this is they're betting that I'm not gonna make it. One of the other things that, you know, I realized, my son is on this travel baseball team, and his coach tells them when they're down a couple runs and they need to pep it up and they need to get going, he turns to the little kids and goes, you know, why not us kids? Why not us guys? Why can't we do this? And that was something that kind of reminded me of something when I was on these journeys to try and better myself. I would say, why not? Why not us? Why not me? Why not? Why can't I be like that guy? Why can't I be like Tom? Why can't I be healthy? Why can't I be the guy that eats right, that exercises, that has a normal life, that isn't doing what I'm doing? And I thought that, and that was something else that pushed me. Why not us? Why, you know, why not us? Why can't that be me? So this is phase one. But I'll tell you a little bit about what I eat, so you can think about, you know, when you transition to phase two. Typically, for breakfast, I'll have like egg whites and salsa. It's pretty simple. I get the container of egg whites and I put it in the nonstick pan. I put 2 scoops of pico de gallo salsa. Costco sells these containers. I'll have whole wheat rounds. It's like whole wheat bread, peppered shawarma or something like that. That'll be typically for breakfast, or I'll still have an HMR hot cereal, or this morning I had a HMR shake. For lunch, I'll have a salad with grilled chicken. Next to my office, there's an Italian place that I usually get that from. I'll sometimes, if there's a Chinese place, I'll get steamed shrimp and steamed vegetables. There are options out there. You know, typically for dinner, we'll still cook things. We'll cook things in the house. Now we go out. I find when I was in phase one, it was nobody wanted to invite me anywhere. You know, I wasn't going to parties. And I'm in phase one, and all of a sudden I'm being invited to parties. I'm invited to weddings. I'm invited to, and it's like all this food, all this. All of a sudden now I got to go to all these things, and I'm not eating anything. And another thing, how many times do you guys do this? Go to the refrigerator and open it up still, like 100 times a day. There is nothing in there that I can eat, but I'm still going in there like 50 times a day.
I love this guy already.
But it's good because it counts as physical activity. Open the refrigerator. But I couldn't believe, and I still do that. For dinners, we'll go out. I found an Italian place. My wife is Italian. She's a great Italian cook. I couldn't not go without that food. But I found things in my favorite places that I could eat that was healthy, and I bounced them off the nutritionists here, in the program to find out what is good, and did a lot of learning in the transition to phase two of what I can eat, what is good. You know, one of the other things is, you know, like now I will eat anything, but it comes down to the frequency and quantity of what it is, and I learned that from here. And Kira says, I don't know if anybody's met Kira, but she has an Irish accent, and I keep hearing my head frequency and quantity in an Irish accent. And I was on a business trip, and I was on an airplane, and I rented this movie Brooklyn, and it's about these Irish immigrants, and it was like, it set the tone for my trip because it was like 2 hours of Irish accents, and I'm like, I'm gonna be good, I'm gonna be on track for this trip. Kira's yelling at me somehow, but you know, so I'll still have a slice of pizza. Because that's why this program, I was on Atkins, I lost 30 pounds on Atkins. I got off Atkins and I gained 60 pounds. And that's everybody's nodding their head. That's anybody that's done that diet, that's what happens. It's not a way for life for me. I could not go the rest of my life without eating bread. I could not go for the rest of my life without eating certain things. But it comes down to frequency and quantity. So I can have that slice of pizza, I just can't have an entire pie. And I can't have it every single week. I have eaten an entire pie. That usually was my MO, you know, many times. So you didn't see my picture in the beginning, but that's the thing. You can't have it every week. And that's what I was doing. I was eating a lot of everything. I was eating garbage, and I was eating at the finest restaurants in the world. I was eating way too much and way too often. And I wasn't getting any physical activity. I sit behind a desk for 12 hours. I'm the guy that we would go to Target, and I'd pull up in the front of Target. My wife would get out, walk around the store, and I'm sitting in the truck in the driver's seat and waiting for an hour for her to walk around the store and do her thing. Now, I park the car, you know, generally a little further than, you know, I could. I don't get the first spot. And I walk, with her around the store, and, you know, it's something. It's just, I try to do little things here and there just to do something. You know, even if it's a day that I can't do the physical activity that I need to, I'll make sure I do something. Make sure I go on the treadmill for 10 minutes. Make sure I do walk, you know, somewhere, do get something in there. With the pizza, I have certain rules that I've created for myself when I transition to phase two. So I will have the pizza. I won't have it every day. I won't have more than one slice. I will fill up on salad and a piece of grilled chicken before I eat that slice of pizza, so I'm not tempted to eat multiple slices and fill myself with, you know, lower calorie good stuff. And I'll only eat that pizza fresh from the pizzeria. So I'm not going to eat reheated pizza, I'm not going to eat frozen pizza, I'm not going to eat Pizza Hut. It's got to be a really good pizzeria, and it's got to be fresh. And that's the only way that I'll do that. Some other things like a burger. I'll make my own burger. I hate saying this, but I, you know, Target, they sell food, and I buy this Laura's Lean ground beef from Target. It's 98% fat-free, and they have patties, they have ground beef, and it's 98% fat-free, and I make that, I put it on a whole wheat bun, I put a couple slices of avocado, which is a healthy fat, and it counteracts the lack of fat in the meat, maybe a slice of pickle on there, and it's perfect, and it does the trick. I've learned how to, before this, I used to spend all this time trying to recreate restaurant dishes at home and make it taste like a restaurant, and we did a pretty good job at it. Now we've tried to figure out how we can make the dishes that we like, but healthy, the healthy versions of them. And they're not exactly the same, but I found they do the trick, and it's not worth the extra calories from the other places. And two things that helped me. There's a couple of books by Rocco DiSpirito. He's a chef, and he came out with these. He did a whole thing where he started to lose a little weight. He was never really overweight, but he lost a little weight, and he started all these low-calorie cookbooks. This is the negative calorie diet. I wouldn't follow the diet, but some of the recipes are good in here. Listen to the people at Winthrop. And then now eat this Italian. This is all Italian cooking, but the healthy way. So he makes a chicken cutlet parm in here, and what he does is he takes this puffed rice cereal and he coats the chicken breast with the puffed rice, ground up puffed rice cereal, sprays it with Pam, puts it in the oven, cooks it in the oven, puts tomato sauce and a slice of fresh mozzarella cheese on there, which is better than the brick of Palio. So there's a lot of different things that I've learned, and those books have helped in bouncing things off the nutritionist. If I were to go out to dinner, I'd send the menu of the restaurant, the website of the restaurant, to Kira. And really? You know, look at that. You take full advantage of them. I would send Kira 10 emails a day. You know, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? I'm doing this. I'm feeling this. I had a, you know, rough day. You know, she's my sponsor. I would sit there and call her and email her and do the same thing with Tom. And I hope you get 500 emails. but it's that's why you're here. We're not in here to do this on our own. We're lucky enough to be in this great program that has people have had tremendous success on this program, and you have experts that you can bounce things off. Ask, tell them how you're feeling. They know, you know, because they've seen hundreds of people like us, so they know that. I was going away, and I knew a couple of the restaurants that I was going to be eating at, and I sent Kira the websites and the links to the menus, and she looked it over and she said, try this, try that, eat this, you know, ask for this, but no sour cream and no cheese. Okay, good, perfect. So, and I had a plan. I sent her all my recipes for, we had Christmas at our house, and I sent her copies of all the recipes, and she calculated the calories and figured it out, how much of what I could have, and this is good, try and stay away from that. So some of my rules are, you know, around the food, the pizza thing. But the one of the other things is my physical activity. I was never physically active. And I played in fifth grade Little League for about two innings. I played left out. But I was never active. I was never into sports. I was never on a team. I still aren't. So I have to push myself to get on the treadmill, to go and do those physical activities. And some of the tricks that I did is in the beginning, I downloaded audiobooks. And one of the audiobooks that changed my life is called The 10X Rule. It's by a guy named Grant Cardone, and it's the 10X rule basically is 10 times the thoughts and 10 times the actions of average people. And it's basically taking your goals and what you think it will take to accomplish those goals and multiplying them by 10. And one of the concepts in the book is that one of the reasons why people are not, and it's a business book, it's not about weight loss or anything like that, but I used most of the concepts for my weight loss journey. And one of the concepts is we set our goals too low. And people set their goals because I want to make attainable goals. I want to make reachable goals. I don't want to set it so high that I'm never going to reach it. But he's saying, no, shoot for the stars and multiply and make these ridiculous goals. So one of the things, I told you that, you know, I've been on multiple diets beforehand. And one of the things, I always said that I need to lose 60 pounds. Because I don't want to be emaciated. I don't want to look like, you know, some skinny guy. I think I need to lose 60 pounds. So I would always start a diet and go on and say, I need to lose 60 pounds. And the problem with that is I would never make it to the 60 pounds. I would always fall short of it. So I listened to this concept in this book about making my goal higher and something, getting something extreme. And that's why I like this program. And I said that I'm going to lose 100 pounds. I still thought that I wanted to lose 60 pounds, but my goal was to lose 100 pounds, because if I was shooting to lose 100 pounds and I lost 80 pounds or 70 pounds, perfect. I'm still on track. I still met my goal. And I ended up losing 110 pounds. One of one of the other concepts in the 10X rule book is to take away your excuses. And that was one of the biggest things, that I made an excuse for everything. I would sit there and go, you know, if I were rich, I would be able to be thin because I would have all the time in the world, and I'd get up at 9 and I'd go and work out, and then I'd go to work at like 10, 11 o'clock and I'd have plenty of time. No. What I could do when I got rid of that excuse was, Dan, get up an hour earlier. You can make time. So I started to get up an hour earlier, and that's when I would go for my walk. In the book, he talks about how, you know, a guy owns a business, and there's a hurricane or there's a storm or something, and the electric company, you know, the lights go out, and the guy blames the electric company why his business was down because, you know, the electric company had all the lights go out. No, there's no excuse. You should have had a backup generator, and if you would have had a backup generator, you could have run your business, and you would have not lost any business, and you would have been fine. So that was one of the concepts, to take out excuses. I do not accept excuses from anyone, especially myself. And once I stopped accepting excuses, that's when my world changed. My entire world is completely different, excuse me, today than it was before I started this program. Was an Allstate agent. I sold my smaller agency. I bought another business 4 times larger. I have a better relationship with my wife. I'm a better father for my kids. I'm more active in the community. Completely different. And it started with the structure in this program and kind of sprouted from everything else. The other thing, especially in phase 1, I treated this as my full-time job. This was not a hobby. It wasn't a part-time job. My full-time job was to take care of myself. I'm finally in a program and that is supportive, that has worked, and I'm going to dedicate everything to it. And it was my full-time job. And a lot of things had to be put on hold, and everything else wasn't perfect, because up until this, I put everyone and everything else before me. If my wife needed to do something, I would stop what I'm doing and take care of what she needed. My kids needed something, my customer needed something, and I would leave myself for last. And what I did here was I put myself first, because I could not be Fat Daddy, could not be the best husband for my wife. I could not be the best father for my kids being that person. I wasn't. My weekends were spent sitting on the couch watching the Food Network. I would sit there and I would be devious and put it on, make my wife watch it before we ate breakfast so she would get hungry, go to the store on an empty stomach and buy a whole bunch of food and cook it for us. And that was our life. You know, that's what we did. We didn't do things. And one of the things that we did in phase, because my wife also did the at-home version of this, and she lost 60 pounds and did well. She's had ups and downs because she hasn't had this. She doesn't have a group. She doesn't have access to the nutritionists that she can bounce things off. She doesn't have a family, a group here that she can bounce and tell people how she's feeling. It's only me, and it's not perfect. You know, it's not, you know, she doesn't want to hear my advice a lot of the time. So that's why I take full advantage of the groups, come to the groups, speak to the nutritionists. We do a lot of planning. We plan all our meals. I have in my kitchen, I have a blackboard, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And it's got what we're going to eat for breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Really?
And it's a lot of work, but we know exactly what we're going to eat. So there is no excuse when, like tonight, I'm going to be home at 8 o'clock tonight, and I know that tonight is grilled chicken and broccoli Rob night. And I know that that's going to be there, and that's what I'm eating. Because if I came home and there was no plan, what do you want? I don't know. What do you want? I don't know. Where do you want to go? What do you want? And you end up as I did in the McDonald's drive-thru. And I spent probably 5-6 days a week, at least, and multiple times a day, eating fast food and garbage. I wrote in my phone when I started this that food is my best friend. Food was my best friend. I really felt that. When I was happy or I was in a great mood, I would celebrate in the McDonald's drive-thru. If I had a crappy day, terrible day, I would be sitting there eating my Taco Bell Mexican pizza and sitting there and pouring all the sauce on it and crunching into it made me feel better for about 5 minutes. And then I felt terrible, especially when I was trying to get ready for a party or a meeting. And I'm sitting there and I'm looking at myself in the mirror and I'm trying this on and trying, I've got my bed is filled with 1,000 different clothes, my entire closet's a mess, and I'm trying to, and I end up wearing the same thing all the time, which is a black shirt and jeans, because that's what looked best on me. And no matter how many things I tried, that's what I would wear. And one of the other things that, when people ask me what caused me to do this, what kept me in, I was in the box, by the way, in phase one. What a great numbers. 100% of the time. I did not go out of the box at all until I got to my goal weight and went into phase two.
How long were you in phase one?
I was in phase one for 6 months. And it was not easy. Like I said, I was invited to all these things. I had my agency, we support the Purple Purse Foundation, which is a foundation that supports victims of domestic abuse and financial abuse. And we were asked to come to represent all the agents in New York at the Plaza Hotel in the city for a cocktail gala reception in Tommy Hilfiger's penthouse apartment and sip champagne out of Tommy Hilfiger's gold-rimmed champagne flutes and eat hors d'oeuvres and the most amazing little tiny finger foods that are out there, and I passed on everything. In fact, what I did in phase one was I took my little box meal and I brought it to the hotel. Wait, it gets better. The hotel, everybody was telling me in group, go to the hotel, ask them, you know, generally, and they generally do, we'll heat up your meal for you. This hotel would not. Nope. We cannot put outside food in our microwave. It's not proper. I don't know. Whatever. So I took my meal. I was dedicated. I was going to do this. And I took my meal and I put it in the bathroom sink. I plugged up the sink and I ran hot water over it for 20 minutes until it warmed up. I'm a germaphobe, and it was the most disgusting 20 minutes of my life, but I did it, and I felt so empowered that I did it. And that's why, you know, I say that I'm really happy to be back in phase one, because phase one was the best time, because it was the most difficult thing I ever did in my entire life. It was painful. I was, as my wife said, bitchy. I was tough to deal with. It was tough. You know what it is. But it turned out to be the best 6 months of my life, because the feeling of accomplishment, I feel like I can do anything. I mean, I was lost before this. I felt like a big mess. I feel today that I can do anything, and it's a very weird thing to say. I will tell you another thing. If anybody loses 100 pounds or more, one of the second best thing in the world is to go on an airplane. Because I would travel and I'd sit in the seat and I'd sit like this with my arms here because I don't want to interrupt anybody else. I'm sitting here, and
if you can get the seatbelt on
and extend it,
The last time I was on an airplane before this, I was on a plane back from Vegas, and I'm sitting there. My ribs were killing me because my stomach was pushing into my ribs, and I was in so much pain. And I went to Disney a couple of months ago, and I'm sitting on the plane in coach in a regular chair, and I lost 110 pounds. And I'm sitting there, I'm like, wow, big seats. honey, did you pay extra for this? And then I realized, holy cow, you know, it was the most amazing feeling to be sitting in a normal seat.
No second belt.
Either. No second belt. No, you know, no dirty looks from the people walking up the aisle going, oh man, I hope I don't sit next to that guy.
Exactly.
And feeling that. And one of the things that that stick with me, and if I could put into why, you know, one of the things, when you have a tough day, when you're thinking about going out of the box, when you're thinking about giving up, think about why you walked through those doors in the beginning. Hold on to that for dear life, and don't let go of it. If I had to put into words my why, is because the pleasure that I would get from eating food no longer... Hey,
oh, wait.
How's it going? The pleasure that I got from eating food no longer outweighed the pain that I felt for getting ready for one of those parties. And that, I would look at it, and I, you know, we had a meeting, and they brought in garlic knots, and I picked up one of the garlic knots, and I literally cursed at the garlic knot, because I, you know, I was pissed off at food. That food, my best friend, did this to me. And one of the, I was talking about McDonald's before and how much I love McDonald's. I actually wanted to buy a McDonald's franchise at one point. And I actually studied McDonald's at Hofstra when I went to school. And I took a course called The McDonaldization of Society. And do you know why there are playgrounds in McDonald's restaurants? Anybody know?
Kids up on the food.
Pretty much. It's
parents have something to do.
No, it's so little kids associate McDonald's with fun. So when they're old enough to go travel and pick a place on their own and have the driver's license and they go anywhere, they go to McDonald's because that's their happy place. And I thought that, you know, at first, I mean, college, I thought that was really cool. That's why I wanted to buy a franchise. But then after this journey, I'm sitting here thinking, that's horrendous. And if they're putting that much thought into a playground, how much thought are they putting in, money are they putting into their food to make sure that the mixture of salt, fat, and sugar is the right thing to get people hooked on their food? And I honestly think that I was addicted to food, especially specifically McDonald's. But, so that's, and does anybody have any questions? Does anybody have, yes, please.
Sorry. If you reach your goal, why are you returning back to phase one?
Well, I mean, phase one being with you guys in this best, in this yeah. in this class, in this with you guys here.
Yeah.
No. I thought you were returning to the.
No, I mean in this, with the talk in the group with phase one people. But I still am in phase two. I still go. I don't go every week, honestly. But I do come at least once a month, and I'm still part of the program. I'm still part of the group, and the reason for that is because the group is powerful. I need the support. It helped me this week alone. I lost 3 pounds this week from just being, you know, immersed in this group.
As a follow-up, do you feel, because you mentioned about the frequency and the portion of it, but how about the preparation and condiments? And because you mentioned you had grilled chicken. You know, I'm talking about outside food now, because right. You're on outside food.
Sure.
So you have... Do you find that the way that you prepare it and what recommendations would make a huge difference, and what recommendations would you give us?
I prepare food in the beginning of phase one. I was really strict, really, really strict. So I would prepare foods with no oil, with only the PAM spray and a very little bit about it. I would eat steamed vegetables only. Now I'm getting a little more adventurous because in the beginning of phase two, I continued to lose weight, but I still felt like I was on a diet. And the purpose of phase two is not to feel like you're on a diet and it's a healthy way of life. Today, as I'm standing here now, I don't feel like I'm on a diet. I have maintained my weight from my lowest weight when I transitioned into phase two to now. I have gained about eight pounds back, which is typical, and Tom can go into the specifics of why that happens. But I'm not as strict as I was in the beginning. I'm not, you know, going crazy, but I don't feel like I'm on a diet. So I would, prepare grilled chicken. I would basically take grilled chicken. I would marinate it in beef broth that is, there's like zero fat, low salt, Swanson beef broth. And I put beef broth and some garlic and some other stuff, and that's what I would marinate it in. Maybe, fresh like lemon juice or vinegar or something like that. But I, you know, anything that are the normal mixtures but without the oil in the beginning. I would steam things. I would eat a lot of steamed things, roasting things. It's really easy to take vegetables. If you like vegetables, you can take so many different vegetables and roast them. Put them in the oven, spray them with the PAM, put some salt, pepper, light on the salt for the, because you don't want that to affect your water retention, and put it in the oven and roast it in the oven. That's what I would snack on. One of the other things my wife is a huge part of this. She's been so supportive of it, and she would spend hours on the weekend chopping up vegetables, putting them in little Ziploc baggies and putting them on the refrigerator door so that, when I open that refrigerator door, I would go in there and there'd be vegetables sitting there and not other stuff. So I'd have the bags of food. We'd take them to go with us. We'd run with them. So it's a lot of the preparation, a lot of grilled, roasted, steamed stuff. And it's amazing that, and a lot of those stuff, a lot of those things are in the book. Like there's a he makes a lasagna with that lean ground beef, the 98% fat-free meat. He puts one layer of pasta, but he puts two layers of a really thinly sliced zucchini or eggplant in there, and it kind of makes up for the layers and it makes up for all these things. And that's also what the groups are good for, sharing ideas, sharing recipes. I know in phase one I learned how to turn the make the muffins and turn the cereal into muffins and the powder. And my wife made, it was for my birthday, she made a cake out of the HMR stuff. She made the muffins and made a muffin mix. That's what the other thing I would do. I would make the muffins into every shape. We've got all these different shapes from Bed Bath & Beyond. So the muffins are now star. Oh, that tastes different from the brick and all the different things, and it was like a little different. So we would, and then she took the pudding, the lactose-free shake, and put it on top as icing. So we got creative. We had to get creative. We had a lot of time on it. Yes.
So you finished your phase one before you went into phase two. So you basically lost all your weight.
I lost the majority of my weight in phase one, and then I lost the 10 pounds in phase two. So I continued to lose weight in phase two.
And also, just explain to them just how you move from decision three to healthy solution.
Yes. Okay. Yes. So in the beginning, I said I was going to lose 100 pounds, and I told everybody that I came across that I'm going to lose 100 pounds. And the reason I did that, there are a lot of people didn't agree with me, but the reason that I did that was I wanted everyone around me to hold me accountable. So I told everybody at my family barbecue that, I'm going to lose 110 pounds, that's why I'm not eating that, or 100 pounds, I'm going to lose 100 pounds, that's why I'm doing this. So that the next barbecue that I was at, and Anthony saw me eating a cheeseburger, he'd be like, hey Dan, how's that diet going? And so that's why I would tell everyone, so that I would keep on track and everybody would hold me accountable. So if they did see me, I would never be tempted to go outside of the box or eat something inappropriate. So I said I was going to lose 100 pounds. And as I started through the diet, I talked to the nutritionist, Kira, and I said, she said, start thinking about your transitions and everything. And I said, all right, once I lose half my goal weight, so once I lose 50 pounds, I'm going to transition to healthy solutions and add the fruits and vegetables. And I remember, I think it was a Thursday night that I was in, maybe it was a Tuesday night, I don't know. It was in my end of my phase one, no decision free. And I had, my wife was saving a tomato from the garden. And it was like the last tomato that was gonna be there. And it was, and I'm not a big fan of, you know, fruits and vegetables, but it was the most amazing thing because I haven't had that tomato, you know, a real thing in so long. But so as I got to the 50 pound mark, I started to freak out because I'm like, all right, I'm at the 50 pound mark. I don't wanna start, I've been so successful just eating the box. And I said to Kira, you know, maybe, you know, 10 more pounds. And once I got to, once I lost 60 pounds, then I transitioned to the fruits and vegetables. And then I got to my goal weight and transitioned to phase two right before Christmas. It was about on December, I think 17th of 2015. So, and then once I got into phase two, one of the biggest transitions, one of the biggest helpful things, and you'll hear about it and learn about it in the groups, but the MyFitnessPal app, it's a food diary. You type in everything you want. It's got a barcode reader. You can go to the box and hit the barcode and it gives you all the calories and gives you everything on there. And, it taught me a tremendous amount about nutrition. You know, how many calories are in everything. How many carbs are in everything? A medium apple has 80 calories and 20 carbs in it. And that, you know, I know these numbers now from that MyFitnessPal app. And what I would do is I would put everything into the app, and then at the end of the week, I would send my printout to the nutritionist, and she would look over it and, you know, give me some tips. Like, you're doing good here, you're eating a lot of snacks, you know, maybe have a bigger lunch so you'd have less snacks, and, you know, give me tips, and I'd learn different ways to eat. And that was the other biggest thing that I got out of this. I learned how to eat, when to eat, what to eat. And they don't teach this stuff in school. We don't know this stuff. You know, it's not our fault. We've been trained to eat this way. We're constantly bombarded with TV commercials and everything, you know, and this is our chance to learn about how food affects our bodies, how it affects our moods, how it affects our energy. And I've learned a tremendous amount, and that's why now I still have to think about things. I still have to plan my meals. I still have to, you know, if we're going to go out to dinner, I still have to think about, you know, what's out there. I'm not as concerned now, because now I feel like it's a way of life. I mean, I've been doing this for long enough that I created a new habit. And that's why I think phase one is so important, to stick with it as much as you can. Obviously, if you're sick or you're not healthy or you can't do it, you know, speak to the nutritionist and do what you can. But if you can, stick to it, because when I stuck to it, I feel like it was my detox. I got rid of my bad habits. I learned that I could survive on this little tiny portion. So I don't, you know, right now, if I don't eat lunch or eat in time, I know that I'm not gonna die. I survived on 800 calories a day. I can get by. So I can live with a bar, and that'll be my meal replacement for the day. But this is a great opportunity to break bad habits and create new good habits. And I really felt like I did that in phase one and phase two, and that's why I still come to meetings and helps me continue the good habits. Because now, like I said, it's second nature. This is my life. I know that, one more tip about physical activity before I forget, because it's important. The audiobook that I was listening to, I would only listen to that audiobook when I was walking in the morning. And I really enjoyed the audiobook, and I couldn't wait to get to the next chapter. So one of my rules was to only listen to that while I was working out or walking. And now, last Christmas, I bought myself a treadmill. And I did that to take away the excuses because, you know, it's icy out. I shouldn't walk. I might slip and fall. And, you know, I keep using that excuse into June. But I got a treadmill, so I got rid of the excuses. And on the treadmill, I have my iPad or my iPhone, and I have Netflix. And I Netflix binge on the treadmill. And I will only watch these shows in the next episode unless I'm on the treadmill. And I actually look forward to getting on the treadmill because I'm going to watch my next episode of my show. And it's a way that I've kind of tricked my brain into kind of liking the going on the treadmill. But it's creating new habits, and that's what's so important about phase one is you're getting rid of old habits. It's tough, it's difficult, but it will turn out to be the best thing that you've done. Yes?
So I have a question about what you thought of yourself before and afterwards. So there's this almost deliberate ignorance where I never saw myself as fat until I'm confronted by a mirror or trying on clothes for an event, right? Don't see my, and then you're faced with that reality for a little while. You satisfy yourself with food, and then you move on to life, and you sit on the couch, and you're deliberately ignorant, right? So my head, in my brain never told me I was fat, so I was convincing myself I'm not. Did you think that way too? And then what did your mind change at all? Do you still see yourself as a fat guy? Do you still see feel in your brain inside? I know habits and behaviors you can change and modify, control, but in your head, are you a skinny guy? Are you a fat guy? What are you?
Recovering. Yes, I felt exactly the same thing. I would sit there. And sometimes I remember a distinct time that I had a couple cocktails and I was staring at myself in the mirror and I'm going, Dan, what the hell are you doing to yourself? You know, I'm having this conversation, like, what are you doing? Why, get your shit together. What are you doing? And so yes, you know, and then I would eat food and I'd feel better.
Stay away from mirrors. Yeah.
One of the things that stay away from mirrors, right. Well, and I would hate, you know, walking past one in the store. But one of the things, the beginning of one of my failed diets, my sister posted a picture from Easter and I'm walking with my 2-year-old son or whatever and I look like a big mess. I felt like a big mess. I mean, I really felt disheveled. I felt like a big mess. I didn't feel like I belonged, that I wasn't worth it. I mean a million.
When you saw the picture, but not.
If I wasn't sitting on my couch, in my comfort space where there's nobody else there, I felt fine,
yeah.
And I would avoid going out. I would avoid going to do things, and after I'd get ready for that party, I'd go to the party, and I wasn't myself because I felt out of place. I felt. You know, I'm not going to, I'd be shy, I'd be quiet. You know, I wouldn't put myself out there. Now I still do feel like that guy, deep in my brain. I do feel, though, that I still can do anything. It's kind of a weird place because I do feel extremely empowered that I can do anything. Like,
do you have a fear of that guy and going back to
yes,
that guy?
Yes. Yes, I do.
Tell him if you're comfortable. He's given me a story about like it was like a semi dream.
Yeah. One morning, I my alarm went off to go walk. And I didn't want to get up. I probably hit the snooze button or something and I fell back a little asleep and I was in that like middle doze, you know, twilight phase, and I had a vision of me, fat daddy, just going up with a big smile, looking at me, going like that. It was weird, and it scared the crap out of me.
It seems very ominous. Yeah.
I jumped out of bed, and I got ready, and I went walking.
Well, I have to imagine that. You look great, obviously, and I don't know what weight you started at or where you're at now, but that's got to be back there chasing you all the time.
It's not chasing me all the time.
Let me see.
It's not chasing me all the time. I still have an insecurity in the back of my mind about it, but I do feel like I could do anything. So while I'm held back a little bit, I'm more empowered than I've ever been in my entire life.
What's your fear level of falling off that wagon?
Right now, I'm not very afraid. I'm afraid of I'm afraid of experimenting a little too much, and not, like I said, I don't feel like I'm on a diet, so I'm eating. I'm not thinking as much about it, because I drove myself a little nuts in the beginning of phase two, and that's when Kira turned around and said, well, maybe maybe you should expand a little bit and not be as strict, because I was a little too careful with the no olive oil, no this, no that. And now I'm not on a diet. I feel like I'm.
You trust yourself.
I trust myself.
This is my argument with Tom Constantly. I don't trust myself yet to do that jump to phase two.
You will. I didn't. I didn't. I did not trust myself. But once I got comfortable, once I got the okay from the nutritionist that, you know, you've got this, I felt okay. I was scared to death to go to phase two. And that's why I logged everything in the MyFitnessPal app. That's why I emailed Kira 20 times a day. That's why, you know, I came to the meetings, and that's why I'm still part of this. I do not want to disconnect myself from this place, because I need to get that email from Kira saying, you coming in, you know, this week? And, you know, yeah, I got to come in this week, and I got to make sure that I'm there. I'm not concerned about being back in the McDonald's drive-thru. But I'm afraid of eating too many egg whites, and, you know, my quantity and frequency goes up of healthy stuff. But, you know, I'm still learning. I mean, it's still a process. I'm in my head, though, I'm okay. At this point, I'm comfortable. It's second nature. And again, it's because I've been in it for as long as I have, and broken those bad habits and gained new good habits.
I wish we could take more by just kind of looking at his classes. Everyone give Dan a round of applause.
Thank you.
I'm on my way.